فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
Ibn Abi Shayba narrated from his chain to Zuhri that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to come out on the day of Al-Fitr and do takbir until he came to the Masalla and until he finished the prayer. Once he finished the prayer, he would stop the takbir. Its chain is authentic, it is mursal, it has other shawahid to explain what it means.
روى ابن أبي شيبة بسنده عن زهري عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كان أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يخرج يوم الفطر فيكبر حتى يأتي المصلى وحتى يقضي الصلاة فإذا قضى الصلاة قطع التكبير. إسناده صحيح وهو مرسل وله شواهد يتقوى بها.
This statement in Abi Shayba narrated in his Musannaf, narrated in the second volume, page 164, second volume. And this is the statement of Al-Zuhri, Muhammad ibn Shihab Al-Zuhri. Muhammad ibn Shihab Al-Zuhri is a tabi'i, from Sira'a al-Tabi'i, from the baby's tabi'i. So he can't attribute something to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. It's going to be called Mursal, right? Called Mursal, right? It's disconnected. But the Shaykh says, Isnaduhu Sahih, his chain is authentic up to Ibn Shihab Zuhri. It's authentically connected up to him. But this problem is now from him, Ibn Shihab Zuhri, up to the Prophet, is disconnected. Where's the person being narrated from? So he said, it's Mursal, وَلَهُمْ شَوَاهِدُ يَتَقَوَّى بِهَا. But it has other chains and other things that strengthen it. There's a book called Ahkam al-Eidain, written by Faryabi. There's a book called Ahkam al-Eidain, written by Al-Faryabi. He brings the shawahid in the book. You can find it in there. And now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the Prophet of Allah, يَخُرُجُ يَوْمَ الْفِطْرِ, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to come out on the day of Fitr. فَيُكَبِّرُ, he would do takbir. حَتَّى يَأْتِيَ الْمُصَلَّى, until the Prophet came to the Musalla. وَحَتَّى يَخْضِي الصَّلَاةَ, and until he completed the prayer. فَإِذَا قَضَى الصَّلَاةَ قَطْعَ التَّكْبِيرَ, if he prayed the prayer and he finished the prayer, he will stop saying the takbir. So my beloved brothers and sisters, on Eid day, it's recommended that the person, he does the takbir. And it's as follows that the person says. He says, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar wa lillahi alhamd. He says that. He says that. And there are of course other ways that are mentioned as well. And it's a sunnah, my beloved brothers and sisters, that a person, la yambaghi tarkuha, don't leave it. And it's good to say a bit loud. Not too loud, but it's good to say loud. Especially when you see Muslims who are quiet, you remind them, they should be saying it that day. So when that day comes, the messages and everybody should be saying it. They should be saying it after salawat, and then when they do that. What did she say? And also, the obligation of Eid is a hadith of Umm Atiyah radiallahu ta'ala anha qala, she said, Amarna, that the Prophet commanded us, Amarna ya'ni al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, an nakhruj fi al-Eidain al-Awatiqa wa dawati al-Khudur wa amara al-Huyyida an ya'tazilna musalla al-Muslimin. The women who don't come out of their houses, they're always known to live in the same house, they just don't come out. The women who are on their menstruation, of course, they to leave you. All of them, everyone needs to leave the masjid. That's why they leave their houses. It's a day everyone goes out. Even those women, they come, and they come to the Musalla, but they just stay away from the place where the people are praying. They leave the women on their menstruations, of course, they to leave you. The reason is to show the number. This is about number, it's about coming together, the Muslims coming together. This is sha'a'il, symbols of what? It's a symbol of Islam. It's a symbol of an Islam. And many people take it very lightly. They forget. Also, what's the sunnah that the person used to follow is ayakula tamra ayat tamrata tamrat. Get some dates. Eat odd. 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, 11. Eat odd. Or eat even. Because the Prophet used to declare Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, la yaudhu yawm al-fitr hatta yakula tamrat. He wouldn't leave until he ate what? So remember, Eid al-Fitr, which is the one after Ramadan, you don't you eat what? Before you go to it. صح? لكن عيد الأضحى you eat it after. So the Prophet used to take cat, that's one thing you need to do. Also the Prophet said, should leave their house early. Leave the house very early. To get there before the Imam, waiting for the prayer. And it is also good to go against the road which you take when you were going there. The road you take and the road you come back from, change it, take another route. So you take one path to get there, you don't take that path again, you take another path to come back home. Okay? Based on the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Jabir radiallahu anhu, Imam Bukhari said, كان النبي إذا كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم that the Prophet was كان يوم عيد خالف الطريق. If it was a day of عيد, it would go against the path in which he used to. Last but not least, that day when you see the people come together, the women are coming out, those who are even on their menstruations and postnatal bleedings, everyone is coming out, and you see the park, because and it should be not made in the masjid, by the way. The Eid prayer should not be done in the masjid. It should be done in the musalla, out open. It's a musalla, it's not the masjid. The Prophet said, never used to be in the masjid. But if the Muslims can't, then they can't, right? And they shouldn't. The masjids that are doing it should close their masjids and go to these parks that they do it. To revive the sunnah. Wallahi, when the person or believer sees that day when the people come together and they're all standing there and they're waiting for, just sometimes, just to get your iman increased, just look at the people and remember and let it come to your mind. Ijtima' al-sa'eed wa'hid in the day of judgment when everybody comes. The day when everybody comes and they're going to meet Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. That day, that gathering is going to take place. So the Quran will hajj. Hajj. Wallahi, that was the biggest lesson I took from it. When I went hajj. When I go to the Kaaba in Ramadan. And on the 27th night in the Kaaba, those who've been to it have been to it, it's full, and the Kaaba is full. And you see the, you have to go like 4 or 5 hours early to the Kaaba, because if not, you can't go in. Blocked off. The roads are blocked and it's too crowded. People come from Fajr, go home, in order to be able to pray Tarawih there inside the Kaaba. The 27th is hard to do Umrah. Close to impossible to do Umrah. You can't get inside the Kaaba to go off. And the Sa'i and everything. In the that being said, when you see that jump with hand, that number, all standing there, you're going to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When everybody's going to come to Him, وَكُلُّ عَبْدٍ آتِيهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فَرْدًا everyone's going to come along by yourself. You're going to be accounted. That's the lesson. And everything for a believer is a lesson. He's taking lessons from everything around him. He's just keep tadabbur and tafakkur. He wants to account himself for everything. As Allah said in the Quran, يَوْمَ يَقُومُ النَّاسُ لِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. The day when everybody's going to stand in front of Allah and they're going to meet Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. That's what comes to your mind. And you also remember that day, just like how everybody's not the same in this park who are praying Eid, and they're different, some are more righteous than others. You know when the day of judgment is going to be like that. انظر كيف فضلنا بعضهم على بعض وللآخرة أكبر درجات وأكبر فضلا. And the people are all the same. That day there's going to be people who are just righteous. They're getting shades. VIP, صح? Why? VIP. Right now, subhanAllah, when you take a flight, and you know some people take business flights, I've never done it, you know? Who's ever taken business? Put your hand up. On the bus. On the bus. Who else? On the airplane. Who's even taking a plane? Who's not ready? Alhamdulillah. It's sad because the people who are business in first class, what do they get? They get their bags earlier, they go in there early, then you guys. When they call out the people and they've got lists, they always say business class first, and they go, whoop, they run. So it's those posh people, right? They're just sitting there like, with all your African brothers, like, yeah, that's what I mean. Economy class, that's what we are. We rinse out the economy class, right? So you see them go in, And then they get this nice red tag stuck to their bag and it says business and flashing it in your face. Yeah? And when they go in, you know, they deliberately do it. They make you go through the business class to get to the economy class first. So you're watching their chairs like, wow, is that you're going to sit over there by yourself? And their chairs turn into a bed, a flat bed. And then you go to the economy class and you see how it becomes. They're like, wow. The transition is shocking. I don't know, like, you know what, I'm going to sit here. And they get the food first, you know that, right? They get served first, you know that, right? You probably eat their leftovers. How do I know? It's not because I take it, it's because one time I took an economy class and I was at the front of the first economy, like a sniffing. They get served. So I realized, wow, they're getting taken care of. What I mean by that, brothers, is the reason I mention all that detailed information is because it's not a problem. We're laughing about it because it's no value for me. But we won't be laughing the day of judgment when that happens. A VIP, that day that people are getting shamed and getting protected, that's it. No laughing about that. That's Habul Yameen, that's everybody what they want to be. And that day is a worrying day. Getting lost and out is a problem. So my beloved brothers and sisters, may Allah make us all safe. We finished 30 hadiths. We now got 3 hadiths after Ramadan. That's it. We are finished and done over. 4 or 3?
We've done the 29 just now.
4 more. Okay, so we've done 29. So it's 33 that we're going to do in total. So we've got 4 more to go. This is after Ramadan. So we divide it into what? First 20 days, last 10 nights, and now we're going to do the last. We're going to do after Ramadan. Okay?
Abu Ayyub al-Ansari radiallahu anhu reported, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he who observes a song, the fasts in the month of Ramadan, and also observes fasting for 6 days in the month of Shawwal, it is as if he has observed fasting for the whole year.
عن أبي أيوب الأنصاري رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من صام رمضان ثم أتبعه 6 من شوال فكأنما صام دهر كله.
This hadith is talking about the 6 days of Shawwal, which is right after Ramadan. من صام رمضان, anyone who fasts Ramadan. So this hadith shows us that you have to fast Ramadan. So if you've got any Ramadan on you, you can't do the 6 Shawwal. This is what this hadith shows. Man sama Ramadan. Thumma, after he finishes Ramadan, atba'ahu 6 min Shawwal, and then he follows up 6 with what? 6 of Shawwal. فَكَأَنَّمَا صَامَ الدَّهْرَ كُلَّهُ. It's as though he's fasted a whole year. Some scholars, they said, no, this is not the case. Are you with me, brothers? It means that if they fasted Ramadan, even a lot of it, or portions of it, it doesn't mean you have to fast everything of it. I mean, you have to, but it doesn't mean for you to fast Shawwal, you have to fast everything. It doesn't mean that. It just shows that you fasted. And the person did fast. The strongest is that if this... Can you do a sunnah when there's a wajib on your neck?
No.
Yeah? So here there's a discussion right now. Zah, scholars are saying there's a wajib here. Can you go on business of a person who's not praying dhuhr? Can you pray the other day? Are you with me? Some people come to the masjid, very common amongst the ahnaf, they come to the masjid and they're praying the 2 rak'ah before fajr. Why else they're praying fajr? Have you been to some masjids like that? The people are praying 2 rak'ah over there. The Prophet said, he said, إِلَىٰ أُقِيمَةِ الصَّلَاةِ فَلَا صَلَاةِ. There's no salah if the iqama and the prayer have been established. There's nothing to do. What are you doing? Come pray with the people. The point is, it's wrong because we're doing a sunnah and it's a wajib here. Are you with me, brothers? Are you with me? Some scholars, they said, we have to really look at it in more details. They said, listen, we have to, not every wajib and sunnah are looked like that. What about if the wajib is unrestricted and the sunnah is restricted? What does that mean? It means that you have now got 6 days which is going to go in a month. It's all of the month of Shawwal. Those 6 days are within Shawwal. As for the paying back of Ramadan, it's not restricted to time. It's free, you can bring it whenever. So now we're not going to look at compare where do the sunnah, we're not doing that. We're comparing a restricted with a non-restricted. So from that angle they say that you can pray your six shawwal and you can then do what you want, your wajib. But I need to tell you something. If the person missed all of Ramadan, then of course they can't pray shawwal, right? Are you with me, brothers? Does that make sense? So we have to, there's a way to reconcile between the two views. And I think this is the middle part. If you've missed all of Ramadan, then we say to you, okay, pray, bring the sixth shawwal, and after that, bring back the Ramadan. Are you with me? But if the person has missed less than anything, less than 24, they have to bring back the fasting, the wajib. Because you've got a choice to bring the wajib and that 6 days. Does that make sense? So if you miss Ramadan, 10 days of Ramadan, bring back the 10 days of Ramadan, rest for another 10 days, and then bring back the 6. So, you can still do it. So that's the way to reconcile between the two. This shows us, my beloved brothers and sisters, when a person comes with the 6 days of Shawwal, it really shows that you're really hungry for fasting, that you didn't really hate it. Does that make sense? Some people, when Ramadan is finished, like, Alhamdulillah, Shawwal, nah, that's enough. But the person who adds 6 Shawwal shows that, nah, I'm missing Ramadan. And the fact that you miss Ramadan, that raises your ranks. Your ranks. That is shaw, that you feel it. As one of the benefits and the signs to show that. Yeah, so 2 questions. With this Shawwal, can you choose how you want to fast? Like, I'm going to fast 1 day, let 1 day go. Fast another day, let 1 day go. You can do that if you want to. Is the hadith, what does it say? Man saba Ramadan, thumma atba'u sitta min Shawwal. That's a more. No one can restrict it to you. With it, you can do 3 at the beginning on the first 10 days, and another 3 at the last 10 days. It's your choice. You can make it easy for yourself. No problem. As long as now, so Eid al-Fitr is only one day, right? Is it not one day? Straight after Eid. Straight after Eid. The next day after Eid al-Fitr, you can go in with your fasting again. And I think personally, that's the best. If you're in the flow, get your 1 day rest, go back to it again. Just do it, get it over and done with, inshallah ta'ala, enjoying it.
Sufyan ibn Abdullah al-Thaqafi radiyallahu anhu said, I said, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell me something about al-Islam which I can ask of no one but you. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, say, I believe in Allah, and then be steadfast.
An Sufyan ibn Abdullah radiyallahu anhu qal, qultu ya Rasulullah, qulli. قلت يا رسول الله قل لي في الإسلام قولا لا أسأل عنه أحدا غيرك قال قل آمنت بالله ثم استقم.
This hadith shows that istiqam is steadfast after Ramadan. And I'm going to remind you a statement. What did the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم say when the Prophet died? So what did Abu Bakr say when the Prophet died? إذا من كان يعبد محمدا فإن محمدا قد مات ومن كان يعبد الله فإن الله And the same is said to the person who used to worship Ramadan. مَنْ كَانَ يَعْبُدُ رَمَضَانَ فَإِنَّ رَمَضَانَ ذَهَبَ وَرَاحَ وَمَنْ كَانَ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ حَيُّ لَا يَمُوتُ. If you're worshiping Ramadan and you're a Ramadan Muslim, then of course Ramadan went and of course you're going to be steadfast after the ayah. If you're still worshiping Allah after Ramadan, he's still alive worshiping Allah. Be steadfast. Does that make sense to every one of you? We have to be steadfast like that. If Ramadan goes, that doesn't mean we're Muslims of Ramadan only. Just like some people are only Friday Muslims. We're Muslims, we're steadfast. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَا اللَّهِ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ أَلَّا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي كُنتُمْ تُوعَدُونَ. Steadfast in Islam. إِلَى الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَا اللَّهُ. When you say Allah is my Lord, what do you mean to come with? قَامُوا. Be steadfast upon it. Uphold. Stick to it. And this is the biggest problem that we have as Muslims today. The issue of steadfastness. To uphold what we believe and stick to our identity and to be steadfast on what we're doing. We're very, what do you call it? How could I say? Very energetic. Have you ever seen? I'm something I see on a regular basis. Classes I start a course, the first 2-3 days, no one. Actually, extra chairs that we brought in. I always smile, I know. Yeah, extra chairs, no problem. It's literally Muslims actually touch the energy. Can you think about this? It's hard. I have never had students who have studied with me or taught them for more than 5 years. I've never. It was the eye, when it gets heavier. Stand, you know, yeah. You hear the most laziest, the most, even excuses. I think to myself, the excuse, the energy that you're bringing to make this excuse, it's like how he prepares to see this. You know, put it like this. That energy, you could put it elsewhere. You could actually do it to memorize the work. You could act, the brain that you're using to make up excuse is actually a brain you can use to memorize. You spend so many hours figuring out plan A, that doesn't work, I need a contingency plan B. Brothers, wallahi, istiqamah is very hard. I ask Allah to make us steadfast. Are you with me, brothers? When the companion says, إِيَّاكَ وَالْتَلَوُّنَ فَإِنَ دِينَ اللَّهِ وَحَبَّهِ. Don't be, مُسْتَعَلَمُ whatever leaf that is, it sits on it, change color. Chameleon, huh? Yeah, don't be like that. Be steadfast. You have to be a sore thumb for your sore thumb. It's funny because I study at university, okay? And I study linguistics. And I take my thumb. I think once or twice I took trousers. After that, I thought, SubhanAllah, what happened to you? SubhanAllah. And then they said, رَبَّنَ اللَّهُ فَمَا اسْتَقَامُ وَإِذْ اسْتَقَامُ. That's it, boom. So I wear my thumb. And it's heavy because you go uni, you see many brothers you know, like, wow, you know, different trousers, I didn't realize you. It's hard for people, it's hard for a lot of people. I'm not saying it's wedge, you're allowed to wear trousers, brothers. It's permissible. If you feel comfortable wearing trousers, it's allowed, there's nothing wrong with it. I'm not saying it's haram, okay? Please. I don't want to be misquoted. But I'm just saying. If you leave it off because you feel like I can't work properly with it, that's all right, that's good, that's good. If you leave it because you have inferiority complex, it's a problem now. Does that make sense? If you take off your thobe because you feel like, I'm going to be looked at, I feel like, the issue is not leaving the thobe. That's not the problem. Does that make sense? It's not the problem here. The real problem is the issue of inferiority. Why do you worry about what they think? If you take it off because you feel like, when I take the train, I need to sort of have a bus, I need to run, when I'm in class, I need something, you know, I'm scared something I might be attacked and something might happen to me, so I need to be ready. Good. You can wear shabak kameez. There's a little way out of it. That's it. The point I'm saying to you, brothers, is that istiqam is very powerful. Lidhalik Imam Ahmed, a man came up to him when he got chained. After the Quran was said, it's makhluq, the Quran is created. And Imam Ahmed, they said to him, say, is the Quran makhluq? He said, no. The Quran is the speech of Allah. It's not created. And it's his statement. Based on the ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنْ أَحَدُ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اسْتَجَارَكَ فَأَجِرُ حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ أَبْلِغُهُ مَأْمَنَهُ. So Imam Ahmed got prison, he got taken to prison, and as he was taken to prison, out of his chain, a man came up to him. And he said to Imam Ahmed, Ya Ahmed. Ya Ahmed, I was commanded to be lashed, 1,000 lashes, because of a sin and a mistake I did, a crime I committed. And I accepted to take that. I willingly committed that sin, and I willingly chose to take this beating for it. And you are going to get lashed and beaten for Allah's religion. Be steadfast. Imam Ahmed said, whenever I got lashed, that man's statement would reverberate in my head, I would hear his voice. to be strong on your identity, believe in yourself. Don't let people tell you. We're in a society, wallahi, the sister, she doesn't believe in herself. The Muslim boy does not believe in himself. It's do you believe this? Very weak. Extremely weak. Somebody will tell you something and you just feel weak. You give in, you cry about it. The sister will need to take her hijab off because of identity crisis.
Exactly, they're
confused amongst themselves. It really springs and it comes from the identity crisis. There's an inferiority complex. Wallahi, billahi, Muslims are even scared to quote hadith and ayat when they're discussing with the kuffar. Have you even realized that? There was a recent, one of the assignments I had in the presentation, I went on. And I invited the past. I do my khutbatul hajah. Salah, Allah, I know why. I do it. I said, I have to open the Islamic thing because I'm starting speech. I do it. And when I start my speech and I talk in front of them, are you with me? My presentation was about the linguistics because I do linguistics. So I use it, the Arabic, the Quran, the linguistics in the Quran. It's an opportunity, da'wah. Even this is an opportunity to do da'wah here. So I went to linguistics in the language and how the Quran uses one word, it has two opposites in it. One word, two opposites. And it can be restricted by it. And I was telling them about the Quran, pay attention to this. I said to them, listen, it's the only book who its direct speech and its reverse understanding don't contradict each other. Do you get my point? I'll give you an example. If I say to somebody here right now, Ahi, you're smart. From the reverse is that everyone else has done, you're smart. That's the lazim al-madha. That's what necessitates for my speech. Once I say, Ahi, you're smart, it means the rest are dumb. Isn't that the opposite of the rest? The Quran, both of those don't contradict. The direct speech is giving, and the reverse that you can understand from it will never go against another verse. That's the underlying miracle of the Quran. Underlying miracle of the Quran. And it's the only thing, it's lazim al-madhab is a hujjah. It's a proof, you can use it. Not a human being. Are you with me, brothers? So I was telling them this and showing them proofs and examples of the Quran. I'm doing this. Maybe like six examples of it. Look, this is the linguistic miracles in the Quran. This is why the Quran tested people. And then one person put his hand up and said to me, what about, are you saying that, for example, he was actually an Orientalist. He actually knew the Quran. So he said, and he said, the Arabs can't come with the word, like, for example, from another one of the very small verses of the Quran. I said, yeah, they can't come with that. Not in the context of Islam. You can come with another Arab, I said that before. But this context, the miracle of the Quran is what my brothers. Thumma another, if you take it out of that place in the Mus'haf, there's nothing else you can substitute it. That's a miracle. Nothing will give it justice the way that Thumma another will give it in this context. The siyaq. And now Arab has come with it in that context. When that is the Quran, Allah only told them that I want you guys to come with something like the Quran, Allah never said an ayah. That's why. You just say Thumma another. The Quran wants to look at the context of Rashid and where. The point is, my brothers, then we had they spoke and they said, oh, you're a Muslim? I said, yeah, I'm a Muslim. I'm a Muslim, alhamdulillah. And so I told them, this is why we have to. The point I'm saying to you, brothers, is that we have to be proud of what we have. Are you with me? When kids have a lolly and their parents give them money, all day they'll show you, they have a lolly for them. That's how this religion is. Salah. That's the honest truth. We're happy with what we have. We have a gold, we have a treasure. And we need to feel that in our hearts. We don't feel weak in front of anyone else. But we will if we don't know our value. If you don't know what you've got in your hand is gold, you don't really know value what you have. That's why you become scared when they use technical terms like, oh, no, nothing. Huh? No. We've got three more hadiths and we finish, inshallah. Can we just push it a bit? Just a little bit today. We're majority of that people. Although we've got two more. Just two more. I'll do quickly.
Narrated by Aisha radiallahu anha, if I had some part of the fast of Ramadan to make up, I would not be able to atone for it except in Sha'ban.
عن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت كان يكون علي الصوم من رمضان فما أستطيع أن أقضيه إلا في شعبان.
This hadith talks about the issue of قضاء رمضان, paying off Ramadan. Ramadan is going to come right now, and many of us may have deaths of Ramadan on us. This month of Sha'ban that we're in right now, that we're going to come to, is an opportunity for you to what? To make up. Aisha radiallahu anha, what did she say? كَانَ يَكُونُ عَلَيَّ الصَّوْمُ. Some fasting may be on my neck, and I will then wait for Sha'ban, and I will pay back in Sha'ban. So whatever fasting that you do have, pay in Sha'ban. But as I said, my beloved brothers and sisters, this just shows what Aisha chose to do. As a believer, you shouldn't delay it anyways. Because Allah says in the Quran, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَىٰ مَغْفِرَةٍ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ عِدَّةٍ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ أُولَٰئِكَ يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْخَيْرَاتِ وَهُمْ لَهَا سَابِقُونَ. Hasten to the good. So when you have to pay a debt off, what you need to do is to hasten to pay it off quickly. Now, this is the last option.
Aisha radiallahu anha narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, whoever dies while he still has some fast to make up, then his heir should fast on his behalf.
An Aisha radiallahu anha, anna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam qal, man mata wa alayhi siyamun, sama anhu walidiyuhum. Waliyuhum.
Now this hadith mentions the Prophet ﷺ said, anyone who has fasting on him and he dies, even the brothers, he dies. Somebody who is fasting, he's fasting and the Ramadan, and he's got debt on him that he needs to pay back, and he dies, those who are going to inherit him, the people who are going to inherit him, waliyu is in warith, those who are going to inherit him, your qaraba, your relatives, they're the ones who are going to pay back for you that fasting. They have to pay back for you. Scholars, they differ upon this issue in two views. This hadith, in this context that it was mentioned, some say that it was meant by that fasting which is so never. If a person said, if you do this for me, I'll fast. And they said, oath. Based on it, they said that this is all you're referring to. And that Ramadan doesn't fall on it. Okay? And they said that there's asiyaqu min al-muqayyidat. That the context restricts that meaning, and that's what it is. And I used to hold that opinion, I used to think it was only nether. But the usage of the Prophet's statement here is unrestricted. He said, "Man mat wa alayhi siyamun," a fasting was on him. This is a natural. Sharp this before it, because siyamun is tanwin and takhir in the Arabic language. Man is shartiyah. So if a natural to fisa, a sharp to fi bu'um, show generalization. It's any fasting that's upon you that you have to fast. If you die and there's debt on you, then once you're going to inherit, you have to pay that for you, and it's obligatory on them. And that's what the Prophet ﷺ said to the woman, the man who came to him. He said, "Inna ummi, my mother, matat wa alayha sawm shahr. A fasting of a month was upon her. Afa aqdiha anha, should I pay it back for her?" The Prophet said, "Law kana ala ummika dayn, akunta qadiyatun." If there was debt on your mother, money, and somebody wanted their money, will you pay that for her? And he said, "Na'am." The Prophet said, "Fadaynullah al-haqqu an yuqda." Allah's debt is the most befitting for the person to pay back. I just wanted to say, barakallahu feekum. The administration of this masjid allowed me to go through this book with the general mask and the Talabat al-Ilm. I also thank all the brothers who came and participated and listened, those who started from the beginning until now. May Allah Ta'ala write you and bring you and resurrect you with the scholars, with the people of knowledge and the righteous people. May Allah also forgive me for any mistakes, any shortcomings, any errors that I might have said whilst I was explaining these ahadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And I say from the bottom of my heart, I also appreciate the food and everything that was done for us. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا واسرافنا في امرنا وثبت اقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم لا تجعل الدنيا اكبر همنا ولا مبلغ عيوننا ولا تسلط علينا بذنوبنا من لا يخافك فينا ولا يرحمنا. رب ات نفوسنا تقواها وزكيها انت خير من زكاها انت وليها ومولاها. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اشهد ان لا اله الا الله استغفرك واتوب اليك.